That you have come to church this morning, and that we are here to honor the Father. Amen. So if you'd like to stand with us this morning, and we'll begin with some music.
Good morning. Again, happy Father's Day. It's already been a blessed Father's Day for me. My wife and kids had a gift for me this morning and wonderful cards. And if the Lord allows, we'll drive an hour and I'll get to hug my dad today. So it's a blessing. We're glad you're here to worship with us this morning. And ultimately, we're going to talk about our Heavenly Father. And it was mentioned in prayer group today that even if your earthly father maybe didn't live up to your expectations, your Heavenly Father will never let you down. So we can all say amen to that. Thank you. Just a few announcements today. Rush Camp, it is rushing upon us. So as it comes up, we told you that we would be collecting a love offering today. There's multiple ways you can give for that. I believe there's a place on the website that you can give for teen camp. We want to be a blessing to any teens that can't afford to go to camp but would like to go to camp. So you can designate it online. You can designate it on your check and put it in an envelope and drop it in the offering plates. And if you're really concerned it's going to get mixed up, hand it to our church treasurer, Donna, back here, and she will make sure that if it is supposed to go to teen camp, it will go to teen camp. So we appreciate anything you can give in order to make it more affordable for our teens to go to camp and spend a whole week worshiping and praising the Lord and learning more about Him. So thank you for that. We'll go on to our next screen. Let's go ahead and recite our memory verse. Would you begin with me? Here we go. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. I didn't get a chance to check today if the screens line up with my announcement sheet. Do we have any more screens? No more screens. All right, I can go for my sheet. Thank you very much. Already mentioned the love offering. We continue to attempt to raise funds for the land purchase that we have talked to you about. We are currently sitting at $72,536, which is a blessing, but we want you to continue to give if God lays that on your heart. As you know, the totality of the purchase price will be $150,000. And I've said this before, that through really good leadership, we have some of the best leaders that any church could ask for, through Pastor Dan's leadership and now Pastor John's, we had quite a bit of money saved, so we could make the purchase right now, but we want you to continue to give. You say, well, I've already given a big gift. Well, maybe God lays it on your heart that this month you have an extra $100 around, you put it towards the land purchase. Again, our big ask is that you continue to pray about it, and if God lays something on your heart, be obedient to the Lord. If you say, I've already done all I can do, God has let me off the hook, then that's fine. You're done. Thank you for your gift. But for the rest of us, continue to pray. Today is the day that we typically bring back the starting point baby bottles. Maybe you're going, oh, I forgot. That's okay. We will take it next week. But please get those in as soon as possible. Remember, those were distributed on Mother's Day. We're supposed to fill them with dollars, 20s, change, all that good stuff, because we want to support the starting point ministry. So if you have one, you can leave it on the back table back there. If you forgot it at home, try to get it to us next week. I think my last announcement is to let dads know that there is some candy on a table over there. At the end of the service today, we would like you to take one as just a small Father's Day gift from your church to you, and we appreciate you. And with that said, let's go to the Lord in prayer. We'll pray for continued worship. We'll pray for Pastor John's message, and we will pray for the offering. Father, it is a blessing to be able to bow our heads and lift up our voices to our Heavenly Father, to our sovereign, omnipotent, omnipresent God, who is always with us, Lord, who is the perfect Father. As men of God on earth, we try our best to be a blessing to our children and our wives and our family, Lord, as earthly fathers, but we can look to you as the perfect role model, Lord, through your word, through the gift of your Son, Jesus, on the cross. And Father, we are so thankful for those gifts. We will continue to worship you today, Lord, because you are worthy. Father, we bring our tithes and offerings and give them to you, and we thank you for them, Lord, because we want to remind ourselves that you are first and foremost in our life, and that if we are faithful to you, you will meet all our needs. And Father, we pray for Pastor John as he brings the message, Lord. We pray that he would be a conduit to touch our hearts and our minds so that we can leave here sanctified. And Lord, that if there's anyone listening via online or in person today that doesn't know you, that the power of your word through Pastor John would bring them to a saving faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. And we ask all of this in your name. Amen.
The song we're about to sing, just as a special for you, is called Run to the Father. And the words of this song remind me of the story of the prodigal son and how the son decided that he needed to go his own way. He needed to do his own thing. And so he asked his dad for his inheritance, and he was gone. And I'm sure that his father thought, no, why are you doing this? Why are you making this choice? This is such a bad idea. And yet he let him go, and he let him be on his own. But when the son returned, not only did the son run to his father, the father ran to the son. And I just think of how God has his arms open. He has them open wide, and he wants you to come to him. No matter where you've been, no matter what choices you've made, he is our heavenly father, and he wants to bring you into his inheritance and for you to be one with him. So here's this song.
Bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now. I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father. I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. So I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Breath.
Again and again, no matter how many times that he brings us back. Will you stand and sing with us?
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a candle for your strength. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my father does. Yeah, failure won't define me, cause that's what my father does. Find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
Prison doors swing wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith.
Yeah.
this time, we're going to dismiss our kids ages 3 and under to the nursery and ages 4 to 12 to Children's Church. And we're going to go back to the bridge of that song, where prodigals come home. And I want you to really think just how great and how deep the Father's love is for us.
Prodigals come home and help us find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors swing wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are paved.
Take your Bibles and turn to Titus. It's right next door to 2 Timothy, chapter 2. Begin reading in verse 1. Before we begin reading, I would like to request that all of the ladies and all of the females be seated. And I want all of the men, all of the males to remain standing. I preached on this theme on Mother's Day, the qualities of a sound mother. And now we will focus on the fathers. Titus chapter 2 verse 1. But as for you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine. That the older men be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love, in patience. The older women likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be blasphemed. Back to the focus of men. Likewise, exhort the young men to be sober-minded in all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works, and doctrine showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. Father, we are thankful for dads today. We are grateful for the gift of fatherhood. We pray today that you would uplift, encourage, strengthen, and give courage and backbone to our dads today to be sound, godly, wise fathers. Men of integrity, men of character, men who focus on the family and lead lead their families to godliness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dads, before you're seated, I want to just let you know this morning that I'm not preaching today to tear you down. I'm here to build you up. I'm not here to put you in your place. I'm here to challenge you and encourage you to put God in His place. I'm not here to criticize. I'm here to uplift. I'm not here to level with you. I am here to lead with you. And I just want to let you know that we are grateful and we are thankful for good, godly, strong men in the house of the Lord today. So thank you for being here. Please be seated. The header in my Bible over chapter 2 in Titus is entitled Qualities of a Sound Church. The context of the word sound means having no defect as to truth, justice, wisdom, or reason. It means competent, sensible, valid. It means strong, secure, reliable, in good condition, healthy, robust. And I believe these three verses that we will look at today show us, these four verses focusing on fathers, show us what a dad needs to be, whether he is the boy going to become a dad, or whether he is the dad influencing his sons, or as the screen shows, a grandfather who is influencing multiple generations. So I want to say four things this morning on these scriptures, looking again at verse 2. First, I want to talk about the qualities of a sound father in church. Titus 2, verse 2 says, the older men, the wise men. This is men who would have been around 60 years of age or older, old enough to be empty nesters and have grandchildren. Those who have lived enough life that they have garnered and gained enough wisdom that only time and experience can produce. And he says older men are to be sober, that is to be wise, godly, discreet. It also refers to wine there, just like it does with the women, that they are able to have self-control and that they do not self-indulge and self-destruct. And then it says, a sound father is to be reverent, holy, honoring to God, temperate, to have self-control, sound, whole, full in faith, to have conviction of truth. And then he is to be sound in love and in patience. So Paul says to young Timothy, or to young Titus, he says, Titus, preach this message to the mature men in your church, the senior sages in your church, that they are called to teach and train the younger men, their boys, their daughters, how to be godly and walk with Christ. Please hear me. It is the older men, the godly men, the wise men of the church to train and teach the children how they are to live for the Lord. It is to be the men, along with the women, but the men are called to lead in the church and in the home. And I want to challenge and encourage our men to keep being faithful, specifically, not just at home, but in the church. Many years ago, I read this book. And I read through it again recently. It's entitled The Disciplines of a Godly Man by Kent Hughes. And he just gives qualities of what a sound man looks like according to Scripture. And in chapter 14, he talks about the discipline of church. And I want to read a couple of excerpts from it. He said, we must not mistakenly reason that one's relationship with Christ minimizes the importance of his church. Yet this is precisely what multitudes of evangelicals assume and act out. Church attendance is infected with a malaise of conditional loyalty, which has produced an army of ecclesiastical hitchhikers. This putative loyalty is fueled by a consumer ethos, a McChristian mentality, which picks and chooses here and there to fill one's ecclesiastical shopping list. There are hitchhikers who attend one church for the preaching, send their children to a second church for its dynamic youth program, and go to a third church's small group. There is a vast herd of professed Christians who exist as nomadic hitchhikers without accountability, without discipline, without discipleship, living apart from the regular benefits of the ordinances. To borrow from Cyprian's idea, they have God as their father, but reject the church as mother, and as a result are incomplete and stunted. The tragedy is compounded because statistics indicate that men are far less committed to the church than women, inevitably producing a shriveled leadership. He concludes this chapter by writing this: men, on the most elementary level, you do not have to go to church to be a Christian. You do not have to go home to be married either. But in both cases, if you do not, you will have a very poor relationship. I am grateful and thankful today that I believe this church goes against the average statistics, and we have good, godly, faithful, obedient, committed men who exercise and lead in the discipline of church. And if you are going to be a sound father, you are going to have to train and lead and be present with your family in the church. I want you to look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. You're close to it. 1 Thessalonians, and see what Paul said, because we need good godly men to be father figures in the church. There are a lot of people even here this morning with heavy hearts because their dads are AWOL or their dads have passed away. And we need good godly men in the church who will pick up that torch and continue to train our sons and our daughters who don't have good godly earthly fathers who have passed on. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, I want you to look at verse 10. And Paul is speaking to those in the church as a spiritual father. He says, you are witnesses. You see in real time, you're witnessing, and God also is witness, how devoutly and justly and blamelessly we behaved ourselves among you who believe. As you know how we exhorted, that is encouraging and comforted and charged, we commanded, we led strongly, we charged every one of you, here it is, as a father does his own children, that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. And so Paul is looking at the young men and women of the church and say, you have a testimony about me. That although I am not your earthly biological dad, and these other men, these deacons and these kids church teachers and these youth group leaders, you are witnesses of them, that they, as fathers to you, lived holy lives and taught you in the instruction and admonition of the Lord. And I would just say, if we are going to be a sound church, we need sound godly fathers in the church who lead and show our children and our wives the right path to follow. Secondly, qualities of a sound father at home. Look down now at Titus 2 verse 6. It says, likewise, exhort, again that is the word for encourage, the young men, the boys, the sons, to be sober-minded. Sober-minded means self-control, to live wisely. But as you can see there on the screen, it also means this: teach these boys, teach our sons and our daughters to be sober-minded. That means to curb one's passions. To curb one's passions. It literally means to be sober-minded means to be sane. Have you ever, fathers, in exasperation, gone in a huff and sat down with your wife at the dinner table and your boy is AWOL and you go, I tell you what, I'm just, and you're just like a pressure cooker of pinto beans about to explode all over the house. Why? Because you say, that boy, I think he just might be a moron. You, teenage boys, you think, and she, your wife, very patiently, stoically, quietly looks at you. Trust me, honey, I know. But that word there, sober-minded, literally means to be sane. And young boys do not have the capacity or the capability or the wisdom to be wise. Foolishness. Little fools, foolishness is bound up in the heart of a sinful boy and girl. But the rod, a good old-fashioned beatdown, the Bible says, will drive it far from them. I'm not talking about abuse, but I am talking, as my father would say, applying the Board of Education to the seat of understanding in animated fashion, to the point that there are actual tears and remorse and regret. If you are giving your child a swat and they go, I'll just tell you, ain't gonna work. They've got to reach the point of remorse, because it is at the point of remorse that sanity starts to kick in. That, oh, I'm not going to do that anymore. The word insane is defined doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result. And we sit down with red faces and grab our son's shoulders and say, I told you for the 500th time. But the Bible says, look, if you want young sons to be sane, to be sober-minded, exhort them. Yes. Encourage them. Amen. To love God and to be wise. And dads, if we're not exhorting our sons, and it's just always the negative, pessimistic, they will continue to rebel. They've got to have some exhortation at home, that it's not just mom giving them the encouragement after dad lays them out, but it is a dad being able to discipline and punish the son, but then look at them and say, I am proud you're my boy. Your sons need to hear. We talked about it in prayer meeting this morning. No matter what generation you grew up in, Dad, your sons need to hear you say, I love you. So I'm not a huggy kind of guy. Get over yourself. If you don't show them love and affection, someone will. That's not good for them, more than likely. Or God will bring, hopefully, a godly man to their life who can give them a well-balanced, sound father figure who will not be afraid to exhort and encourage them and not always just be putting them in their place. There's a tough man, one of the toughest. His name is General Douglas MacArthur. And I want you to hear what the prayer that he prayed for his son. And he's away at war, stationed in Australia, acting as supreme commander of the Allied forces in the Southwest Pacific area. And he penned this prayer for his only son, Arthur. He said, build me a son. Build me a son, O Lord, who will be strong enough to know when he is weak and brave enough to face himself when he is afraid. One who will be proud and unbending in honest defeat and humble and gentle in victory. Build me a son whose witness will not take the place of deeds, a son who will know thee, and that to know himself is the foundation stone of knowledge. Lead him, I pray, not in a path of ease and comfort, but under the stress and spur of difficulties and challenge. Here let him learn to stand up in the storm. Here let him learn compassion for those who fail. Build me a son whose heart will be clear, whose goal will be high, a son who will master himself before he seeks to master other men, who will reach into the future yet never forget the past. And after all these things are his, add, I pray, enough of a sense of humor so that he may always be serious yet never take himself too seriously. Give him humility so that he may always remember the simplicity of true greatness, the open mind of true wisdom, and the weakness of true strength. Then I, his father, will dare to whisper, I have not lived in vain. Fathers, you need to be building and exhorting and encouraging and praying for your sons in the home. I shared this on Friday with a devotional for the church, but in the United States, 23.9 million children live absent of their biological father. Fatherless children represent 63% of teen suicides, 70% of juveniles in state institutions, 71% of high school dropouts, 75% of children in chemical abuse centers. Fatherless children in the United States represent 80% of rapists, 85% of youths in prison, and 90% of homeless and runaway children don't have a father in the home. And dads, our children are desperate to see soundness from their fathers. And we need you to be sound at home. Thirdly, and I didn't have this for the ladies, but I thought it was fitting, felt led to share this one for the men. And that is qualities of a sound father in recreation, in your hobbies, in your leisure, in your fun times. Look again at Titus 2, verse 7. Verse 6 says, exhort the young men, encourage them to be sober-minded, and then in all things showing yourself. You ever heard somebody say, oh, they really showed themselves? The Bible says here, in all things showing yourself to be a pattern. Remember that word pattern. To be a pattern of good works in doctrine, that is the teaching of the Word of God, showing integrity, reverence, again, holiness, incorruptibility. The Bible says that it's in all things that we need to be exemplifying, especially to our young boys and to our sons, that whether we are at church on Sunday or whether we are out with the guys on Friday night, that we are sound and men of integrity at home, at church, and when we are neither and we're out on our own time in recreation, in all things. Proverbs, just write down this reference. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7 says this, the righteous man, the godly man, walks in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. I would like to just read that again in this flavor. The righteous man walks in his integrity, even in his fun. And his children are still blessed after him when the party is over. Because there are a lot of dads that will emulate and impersonate and personify a good godly man of integrity a lot of times at home and certainly at the church. But then if you see them on vacation, they're doing things, they're talking, they're living out, they're involving themselves in behavior and conduct that you don't usually see. And you wonder, what is the disconnect that at church you're this, but at home you're this. And at home you're this, but out with the guys on Friday night you're this. And The Bible says, in all things, show yourself to have a pattern of good, godly works. I have a lifetime. I'm 43 years of age. I have a lifetime of fun memories with my parents and my dad. My dad does not have a silly, goofy personality, but he loves to laugh and have fun. And we've had lots. I've had a lifetime of fun. What has been such a great blessing in my life is that the pastor you saw here and the shepherd you saw here standing in this same place for 22 plus years in this pulpit as the senior pastor on Sundays, and the spiritual leader you saw throughout the week here in this place, is the same man that I saw on Tuesday morning at home. The same man, the spiritual leader that the senators and representatives and Governor Voinovich and the high-ranking authoritative figures in our state and in our nation who saw my father on Wednesday mornings at the State House, and I would be standing beside him meeting the governor and having the prayer breakfast and having all of these men look up to my father and calling him into their offices for years after years after years, asking for his prayer, his counsel, his wisdom. That same man that they saw on Wednesday morning is the same man I saw on Thursday morning at home. The same guy, by and large, Dad, that the businessmen at the YMCA saw on Tuesday noontime, Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, at the YMCA when he played basketball in town with all of the business guys and the college professors, is the same guy that I would see on Friday morning at home. I'm thankful for that. Because my dad, whether it was in the church or at home or in our times of fun and recreation, he still had a good, godly pattern. And he showed himself in all things to be a godly man. And that oftentimes is the breakdown of where we read this morning from Ephesians chapter 6. Fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but raise them up in the fear and instruction of the Lord. The sons are glad to come and follow their dad to church, but then when they see dad misbehaving like an imbecile or like an insane man or losing his temper or giving in to vices on Saturday night, it causes them to reject God's truth. We had a speedboat growing up, and Dad would take us out there and create wakes and love throwing me and my brother off of that inner tube. But my dad never got careless and ran that speedboat into the dock, because he became inebriated and then intoxicated and then was drunk. Never saw that. We always had fun at the beach and with the boat, but never to our peril, because my dad in all things showed himself to be a pattern of godliness, even when we were having fun. And I'm thankful for that. Amen. Never saw my dad drink. Therefore, I never saw my dad drunk. I'm grateful for that. We love to eat out. We love Cracker Barrel. We love... Thank goodness even my dad loves Skyline Chili. He took me there growing up. We love to eat out. But my mother was never embarrassed. Our children were never put to shame because my dad tried to play light and loose and impress the waitress. Never heard my dad ever call a waitress honey, baby, sweetie, darling. Ever. Never tried to, and I have seen this multiple times over the years. Even men in church, well, they'll come in here and they'll be, and then they'll get out in a restaurant, and all of a sudden they become something that I'm like, what is going on there? I don't ever hear you talk to your daughters or your wife that way, but what's with the waitress thing? I'm thankful that we ate out and I never had that experience. We've had lots of guy times and men times, but my dad never had to apologize to my brother or me. And we've had lots of guy time out with Papa and my son and my nephews. Dad's never had to line us up and apologize and say, look, I was trying to have fun. It was just really stupid what I did. No, because in all things, he showed himself to be a pattern. I want you to write down this reference, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 12. It says, keep your behavior honorable among unbelievers, so that when they speak against you, they will see your good deeds and glorify God. Wow. Dads, keep your behavior honorable among your sons and among the lost in your recreation. Can I just tell you something? This just came to me last night, and I want to just add it in here. I just kind of touched on women there and waitresses and things like that. I was thinking about this with Dad and dating. I called my father this morning and I said, Dad, I want to just thank you. I love you. Thanks for being a great godly dad. I was thinking this week as I prepared my message about all the girls that I liked. And there were many. Like Adrian Rogers said, he said, if you are what you think about, he said, I'm surprised I didn't become a girl. It's not really a funny joke nowadays, but whatever. But he whoa. Anyway, I remember my father. There was one girl in particular that I started paying attention to because there were no other options of girls paying attention to me. And my dad took me aside one day, and I went to him, and we were working. I'll never forget it. We were down on the cement slab in front of our garage, and I said, Dad, what do you think about this girl? You remember that Andy Griffith episode? She's nice. My dad said, John, she's a nice girl. But son, you can do better. I called Dad. I said, Dad, this morning, I said, Dad, you remember that? He said, yeah. He said, no, that wasn't the only time I told you that. So I had to tell you that a few times, son. By the time I got to Carrie, he's like, look, you're 25. You just got to take what you can get. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. My mother-in-law is sitting right here. She just held up her purse and went like this. I wanted a girlfriend so bad. I would have dated a gnarly fence post with a raccoon pelt on top of it. I just wanted to be in love. But I'm thankful for a dad who was honest with me. And on the cement slab that day, the reason I went and asked my dad what he thought of that girl is because I knew what he thought of that girl. And although I didn't want to hear it, I knew I needed to hear the truth, because my dad was predictable. And that's the one word, fathers, I want to get when it comes to your recreation, when it comes to your persona at home, at church, in the workplace, be predictable. Because we live in a society of a lot of unpredictable, unstable, undecided fathers. But your sons need to know that you are predictable in all things when it comes to the patterns of your life. And that's one reason we have so many roller coaster boys and girls in our society. There's emotionally unstable, up, down, don't know what this or that, because they have a dad who is never predictable. My dad was predictable. Always. If I disrespected him and was arrogant around him, predictable. Board of Education, seat of understanding. It's going to happen. If I talk back to my mom, predictable. Knocked out for 3 days. when I go to him about the opposite sex. Predictable. It's a little bit like Alistair Begg said. One of the old men there sitting in Scotland. Girl walks by, says, "Nice legs." The old man said to him, "Nice legs. Shame about a face." He was predictable, to be honest with me, to say, son, she's a good girl. Son, not a good girl. My dad did the opposite. Pretty face, ugly spirit. He was predictable. I could count on him to be a pattern. Get that word in your mind. Patterns are so powerful. And my dad was predictable in his recreation as well, and never brought shame to our family, and I'm thankful for that. Lastly, qualities of a sound father in society. Look again at Titus 2, verse 8. It says, "Exhort the young men to be sober-minded in all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works and doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility." And now verse 8, he ends this portion on fathers and sons and godly men, talking about the mouth. It says, "Sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is open, who is an opponent, your enemy, may be ashamed, having nothing. They may not like you, they may not agree with you, but you live your life in such a way and you talk in such a way that they actually put to shame and they don't have anything to say about you." Few things invalidate and harm and weaken your testimony, dads, for Christ, like the misuse of an uncontrolled mouth. But there are few things that can bring more validation and solidify and affirm your witness and your effectiveness for Christ if your tongue glorifies God and edifies those who hear you. I have this book that sits on my grandfather's bookshelf, and on the front page, right inside, there's a note there. It says, "To Reverend and Mrs. J.W., that's John Willett Vest, from Reverend and Mrs. A.L., that's Arthur Lee Vest, February 1965. My grandfather's name is written, this is one of his books, now it's his grandson's books, sits on his bookshelf in my study. It's entitled "The Disciplined Life, Studies in the Fine Art of Christian Discipleship" by Richard Taylor. And in chapter 2, he talks about the marks of maturity of a godly, disciplined man. And I want you to just listen what this old book has to say about speech. "Regardless of how carefully controlled a person is at all of the points, none can qualify for the high rating of a truly disciplined character whose tongue is not restrained by the bridle of prudence and directed by the reins of love. And this is scriptural. James 1:26 says, 'If any man among you seems to be religious and bridles not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is in vain.' One may have a disciplined body, a disciplined mind, a disciplined will, even disciplined emotions, appetites, and habits, but a loose tongue betrays a fatal fault in the armor. The character is defective. Some people pride themselves," and oftentimes this is men, "some people pride themselves on their frankness. 'I say what I think,' they boast. So does the fool, according to the Bible. A fool utters all his mind, Proverbs says. Frankness is indeed a virtue when coupled with intelligent, loving tact and discretion. But it becomes a sadistic vice when it is merely the unbridled eruptings of opinions without regard to times and places or human feelings. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 18 says, 'There is that speaketh like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health.' It often takes a far higher display of discipline to refrain from speaking than it does to speak. He closes by saying this, "The Bible has an astonishing amount to say about the control of the tongue. James clearly makes it the archstone of disciplined living. Chapter 3, verse 2 of James says, if any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man and able also to bridle the whole body." If you can control your tongue, you can control all of yourself. Admittedly, this is a level of perfection which few have reached, but it is within reach of all. And such discretion in the speech should be included in our vision of the disciplined character. So, dads, I ask you this morning, your behavior may be good and right and godly, but what about your mouth? And Paul closes this section out with men by saying, guard your mouth. Set a good example of your words. Be disciplined. Have the mark of maturity that your words glorify your Father in heaven. So again, a sound father. A sound father. A well-rounded, fully devoted, godly man. Is that you, dads? Imperfect, flawed, sinful, weak, and yet we can be good godly fathers through Christ who gives us strength. Is that your testimony? Are you a sound, solid man? I found a great help to me hearing and seeing the story of a tower. You ever heard people describe certain men? I remember playing basketball, a man that just passed away this Thursday. He always towered over me and almost everyone he was around. Big man. And he would say, "Man, look how he towers over them." I was playing basketball one day and got guy tripped over me because he didn't see me and called me a garden gnome. He did. I stole the ball from him. He turned around and chased after what it was. He didn't see it, tripped over me, got up, looked at me with filth and said, "Get out of the way, garden gnome." No pride here on the height thing, but we like men who tower. The Israelites were enthralled by a man named Saul. He towered above all other men, the Bible says, in the kingdom. Head and shoulders above the other men. Big, strong, towered. There's an incredible tower that sits atop a mountain in Argyll, Scotland, that overlooks the beautiful town of Oban. When looking up from the town of Oban, on this mountain, at a distance, it is an astonishing, massive, impressive structure made of granite with a circumference of 660 feet and two tiers of 94 lancet arches. This thing is massive. And as you can see, even at nighttime, it's lit up and it towers over the town. It's beautiful from a distance. It looks good. It's known as McCaig's Tower, but it's more famously known as McCaig's Folly. Because when you get close, at a distance it towers, but when you get close and you walk inside this giant structure of granite, there are no rooms. There is no glass in the windows. There are no beds to sleep in. There are no kitchen tables to eat at. There are no trash cans where you can throw away the refuse. There There are no couches where you can sit together with your family. And this rich banker began to build this structure and was going to put statues of himself and his family. He died prematurely. But this is an illustration of, on the outside, there's this tower. And if you're in the town and you're looking up, you're saying, wow, that's magnificent. But when you go behind the veil of the granite, it serves no real purpose. It's empty. It's void. It's filled with trees. And it never has fulfilled what a granite massive tower was intended to be. To be a home and a shelter and a tower where the Bible says the righteous runs into the Lord Jesus Christ, our tower, and they are safe. And our world is enamored and fascinated with the big, with the tall, with the towers of society, with the outward appearance. And there's a lot of dads that from a distance look good and they've got the stuff going on. But when you get up close and you get behind the veil, there's no real, genuine purpose of their life as a father. The love is gone. The character is not there. The speech is pathetic. There's no real self-discipline. There's no temperance. There's no self-control. They live according to their feelings. They're unpredictable. They're up. They're down. They're side to side. And dads, our children need whole, sound, strong men of character. I want to end again with Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7, that says, the righteous man walks in his integrity. The word integrity is the word integer. It means whole, sound. The righteous man walks in his wholeness, in his soundness, in his integrity, and his children are blessed after him. I'd like you to stand this morning. I want to ask you, fathers, are you sound? Are you a man of integrity? The only way you will be that, the only way you will be a sound father who has qualities of godliness is if you are a saved father. If you've come to that point in your life where you've confessed your sins, repented, believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are saved. Tom, I'd ask you to come this morning and play a verse of invitation. And we're going to sing, where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him all the way. Dads, are you following and being led by the Lord this morning? Would you bow with me for prayer? Father, as we sing simple words, Lord, our dads, our men are called to lead. They are called to lead, but they cannot effectively lead if they are not being led. So Lord, today I pray for our dads that you would infuse them with the power of the Holy Spirit, because they are saved men that you are making to be sound, strong men for the Lord. And God, today, if there's a dad here that does not know you as their Savior, I pray that they would be saved, that they would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. And Lord, today, may this church continue to train, to grow up, and to encourage good, godly, sound men for the glory of God. If we're going to see a spiritual awakening, if we're going to see a revival, if we're going to see our country turn around, we are going to need some good, godly, sound men to step up and stand in the gap for our families and our children. May those kind of men be found in this flock. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Dads, if you need to come, ask the Lord to work in your life. You come this morning. Let's sing it together. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow, follow me. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him, all the way. Go with me, all the way. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. That chorus again. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him, with all the way. Dads, we love you. Be sound, godly men. We want to encourage you. We want you to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Everyone, encourage our men. Encourage our dads. Exhort our sons. And let's have a sound church. We love you guys. You're dismissed.